Dear students, today onwards we will be discussing the hydrogen atom problem, and it is the most essence part of the quantum chemistry as far as I understand, and really you are going to appreciate the subject, what you are going to learn. Of course, we are going through a lot of mathematical derivations, but don't worry about all these mathematical derivation. But that gives, you know, when you are deriving something, that it gives more confidence. But I suggest all of you to go through the mathematical definition, derivation part as well, so that you will appreciate. But at the same time, that you should understand the physical significance of deriving an equation or understanding an equation, what is written. So I will try to give the maximum what I can give, and the previous knowledge what we have learned at the previous classes, like the BSc level, plus 2 level, 10th level, these all these things are actually going to be changed right now after the discussion of this particular hydrogen atom problem. And let me step into the discussion that the hydrogen atom problem, what is hydrogen atom? And the hydrogen atom problem, it is very simple, that you can just look into the Cartesian coordinate system, that okay, it has got a nucleus and it has got a electron. So you can think of like this is a nucleus, the bigger one, and this is something like that, you know, electron, right? And just to find, you know, just to specify its position, that I have put some kind of Cartesian coordinate system. So let us suppose that the nuclear coordinates are X capital N, Y capital N, Z capital N, where N stands for the nucleus, right? And M is my electron, and its coordinates are XE, YE, ZE, okay? And in the vector notation, you can take it like, you know, R bar E, okay? Which it basically tells you the, specify the position of the electron with respect to the Cartesian coordinate system which you are going to define. Similarly, the Rn bar actually represent the vector, and it represent the position of the nucleus of the hydrogen atom. As you know that the hydrogen atom has a nucleus and one electron, and you know, since you have two particle and it is fairly easy, the first job that we should do, any problem that we take up, you know, we should strive to write down the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian, now it can be written, as you can see here in this expression, it is minus h cross square by 2 capital M. What is capital M? Capital M is my mass of the nucleus, okay? And del N square, del N square. What is del N square? Del N square is the del operator that actually represent the nuclear coordinates, okay? And similarly, I have another particle. The hydrogen atom contains two particles. One is nucleus. So nucleus, if it is moving in the space, then definitely it will have a kinetic energy. Therefore, the kinetic energy has been written there, okay? The other kinetic energy due to the electron is written here, minus h cross square by 2 small m, where small m represents the mass of the electron, and del E square represents the position coordinates of the electron. Now you also realize that apart from these you know, the kinetic energy terms, we do have a potential energy term. We do have a potential energy term, and the potential energy term is nothing but it's a Coulombic potential. Therefore, E square by 4 pi epsilon naught, okay, and modulus of Re minus Rn. What is this? This is the distance between the nuclear and the electron, okay? There is a Coulombic potential between the nucleus and electron, because one is positively charged and the other one is negatively charged. There is always a potential develops between them. So that potential is expression is given like E square by 4 pi epsilon Re minus Rn bar, okay, modulus. So you can take the positive, distance has to be positive, so it is taken, it is kept in modulus, right? Now, having understood this hydrogen atom, it's very simple that we know very well that it's a fundamental, is the simplest atom we have in the periodic table. It has got two particles, one is nucleus, the other one is electron. And since you have two particles, so two kinetic energy terms will be there, and if they are interacting, there will be potential energy term. Therefore, the Hamiltonian overall, it has got three terms, two kinetics energy terms and the one potential energy term. Now, the next step, what we should do? The next step is we have to basically solve the time-independent Schrödinger wave equation. As you realize that this is, its potential is not going to change with respect to time. Okay? So whether you record the potential now or the after, or maybe after 1 hour, it doesn't matter. The potential between the electron and nucleus in the hydrogen atom, they in the wave function of the hydrogen atom, it is recommended that we should solve this time-independent Schrödinger wave equation, right? H psi is equal to E psi. So let me write down that, and it is already written here, H capital psi, which is actually a function of the nuclear coordinates as well as the electronic coordinates. Please realize that it is written in a shorthand notation. I should have kept a bar also. Fine, that's not an issue, but then you realize that it is written in a shorthand notation. To specify the position of the electron, we need three coordinates. Similarly, to specify the nucleus, we need another three coordinates. So therefore, this particular hydrogen atom problem, to be precise, it is a six-variable system. In fact, it is a six-dimensional problem. Okay, and just recollect the kind of rigorous calculation that we had done with regard to the quantum tunneling or with regard to the other simple harmonic oscillator. Of course, harmonic oscillator we have considered is a single the one-dimensional system where it is moving in one direction. But then, even for the one-dimensional system, when you have a potential energy term, in the case of simple harmonic oscillator, that is half kx square, we had gone through a series of rigorous calculation to obtain its solutions, right? Now, coming to the hydrogen atom here, that we have a six variables. Okay, these six variables, how do you tackle mathematically? That is a big question, right? So when you incorporate six variables, just see here that the Dell is having three variables here, and then there are three variables here, right? So this actually makes the problem very difficult. But then we are fortunate that the solutions are exactly solved by many of by the efforts of so many people. The solutions are now well established, and it is completely solved. And the hydrogen atom problem, the solutions are exactly known, and it has been done by many of the people. And finally, we are studying the essence of hydrogen atom at the primary level. But here we are going to see all these things, how they actually arrived at these quantum numbers, how they are proposed, the sh different shapes of the hydrogen atom, the orbitals of the hydrogen atom. So all those things we are going to study in a systematic manner. Okay, now the question is, how do we actually solve this problem? Okay, so let me tell you, this is done in a different way. So, okay, just imagine that we have hydrogen atom in a space. Okay, let's say that you are might be in a room, and in the room that we have hydrogen atom. Of course, you can't actually pick up one hydrogen atom experimentally. It's not possible. Of course, there are so many hydrogen atoms will be there. It's a gas, and they will basically, making a, they don't they can't actually stay at one place, and they basically move one place to the other place randomly in the room, right? If you properly seal the room, then the hydrogen atom actually, or atoms basically, they will move from one place to the other place, right? So that motion, what we refer to as actually translational motion. Okay, what is the translational motion? Well, this is the definition of the translational motion. And when you have a hydrogen atom, it is in general. So a particular system can have a translational motion, vibrational motion, rotational motion. So these are different kinds of motion that we can anticipate for any system or any atom or any molecule, right? So when it comes to the translational motion, it is nothing but moving from one space to the other space. Okay, maybe here and there. That is the translational motion. Now, during this translation motion, what is happening is that the center of mass of the hydrogen atom doesn't change. Please realize that hydrogen atom, it is actually it has got two particles. When I said the hydrogen atom is moving, as a whole it is moving. Okay, it's not that the particle, the nucleus is moving and then the electron is moving. No, as a whole it is actually moving from one place to the other place. So during this process, what is happening is that the center of mass is actually changing, right? So that this is one type of translational motion. And other type of motion is that the relative motion. Apart from this translational motion, okay, when you place the hydrogen atom in the room, it is also simultaneously, it is also executing another motion, what we refer to as a relative motion. In this motion, internal particles are actually moving with respect to other, right? So you have electron and the nucleus both actually moving with respect to each other a little bit. Okay, so this is what we refer to as a relative motion. And in the relative motion, what is happening? Okay, so you have electron and you have a nucleus. And if the nucleus is moving, coming this much close, and then accordingly the electron also moves, right? So the distance during this relative motion, the distance between these two, electron and the nucleus, is basically changing. Okay, and during this process, the center of mass doesn't change. During this process, the center of mass doesn't change. So these are the two different motions that we can expect for hydrogen atom. Of course, these are the motion in general for any system, but since our discussion is the hydrogen atom, so you can expect the hydrogen atom can actually execute two motions. One is translation motion and the relative motion. Now look at, having understood these things, so as far as our problem is concerned, the hydrogen atom problem is concerned, the translation motion actually is not very important as compared to the relative motion. Okay, the translation motion is not at all important. Why? Because when I said that the hydrogen atom as a whole is moving, then what is changing? When it is moving, its kinetic energy actually changing, right? So the kinetic energy, if it is changing, and the kinetic energy operator in quantum mechanics, that is minus h cross square by 2 times the mass of the system multiplied by the del square operator. That's the kinetic energy operator. So that you can actually operate it upon a sortable wave function, then we can get the wave function as well as the eigenvalues, which are nothing but the energy values of the system for the translational motion, right? So this particular thing is not going to be very different than what we have done with regard to the particle in three-dimensional box, or maybe one-dimensional box for that matter. Right, so the translation motion is concerned that it has got only one kinetic energy operator, therefore it doesn't basically it's not really very important because it is just a kinetic energy operator, whereas the relative motion, you see that the with respect to the other one is actually changing. With respect to the motion of the electron, the nucleus also will change a little bit its position. Of course, it will not change too much, but to a tiny bit it will change. Therefore, the center of mass actually remain the same, right? So this is the general discussion about translation motion and relative motion. When you keep a hydrogen atom in a room and then it basically does these two motions. Now what I claim is that our Hamiltonian, what is our Hamiltonian that we have already written in the previous slide? This is the Hamiltonian, and in the present form, we don't have the Hamiltonian, or we don't have any terms which actually explains the behavior of a translational motion and the behavior of a relative motion of the head and matter. Okay, so as of now, what you can see in the del kinetic energy operator, we have a del operator that actually describes the nuclei, right? And the other one is the electron. That's all. So you don't have anything. But then you can't understand this Hamiltonian as such, because it doesn't reveal the translational motion and it doesn't reveal the relative motion of the hydrogen atom. I'm sure that you are following my lecture. So the hydrogen atom actually has two motions, but the Hamiltonian, what we have written, doesn't reflect upon these two motions. So my first job in solving the hydrogen atom problem is actually to write down this Hamiltonian in terms of translational motion and relative motion coordinates. Okay, the first part that we are going to take up in hydrogen atom problem is that the Hamiltonian itself is not a correct Hamiltonian, because the real situation is that it has got two motion, but then the Hamiltonian doesn't say anything about these two motions. So we will transform these, we will write down the Hamiltonian in terms of translational motion as well as the relative motion, right? That is the first task. So how do we do that? So to do that, as I told you just now, the translational motion, during the translational motion, the center of mass actually as a whole, the hydrogen atom, if it is moving, its center of mass is actually changing, right? And therefore, I have to define the center of mass. So I am defining the notation for my center of mass, that is capital R bar is the center of mass of the hydrogen atom. And its coordinates are basically X, capital X, Y, Z. Okay, similarly, of course, the center of mass, it can be calculated, right? The general expression for the center of mass is given by capital M Rn bar minus M Re bar by M plus M, right? The mass, total mass of the system. And please remember, these are actually a general expression, but then it has got three components. X component of the center of mass is given by capital M Xn minus M Xc by the total mass of the system, hydrogen atom, right? The Y component is this, and then Z component is this. Okay, so basically we are defining our center of mass coordinates, right? And the next thing is that we will also define the relative mass coordinates. We'll also define our relative mass coordinates. What are the relative mass coordinates? Well, the relative mass, during the relative mass, what is changing? The distance between the electron and the nucleus is changing. Therefore, R bar, small r bar, is a function, basically the relative mass coordinate notation. And it has got again three coordinates, that is X component, Y component, and Z component. Okay, it is just nothing but the Xc minus, modulus of Xc minus Xn, sorry, modulus of Re minus Rn. And the X component is just nothing but Xc minus Xn, Y component is Ye minus Yn, and Z component is Ze minus Zn, right? So once you have, it is just a distance, right? Suppose if the relative mass, during the relative mass, the center of mass remains the same, but the distance is changing, right? That distance can be in an X direction, the distance change can be in a Y direction, the distance change can be in a Z direction. So accordingly, three different formulas. Now having written these things, and the Hamiltonian now, it is written in terms of the Hamiltonian, what we have got, the original Hamiltonian, that is minus h cross square by 2m del n square. What is del n square? Del n square is nothing but the dou square upon dou xn square plus dou square upon dou yn square plus dou square upon dou zn square. So the del operator is basically expanded. And similarly, the other kinetic energy term, that is h cross square by 2m dou square upon dou xc square plus dou square upon dou y square. Y square plus dou square upon dou z square. And the potential energy term is as such. Okay. Now, this is the Hamiltonian. We need to transform to the translational coordinates and relative coordinates. Why we are doing that? Because this Hamiltonian doesn't speak about these motions of the hydrogen atom. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, we can do this. Of course, let me tell you here, there are three terms, like X term, Y term, and Z term, right? So we will concentrate this particular X calculation of X term. Of course, if you can calculate X term, Y term, Z terms can be easily guessed. So we are not going to do the how to calculate the dou square upon dou y n square, and we are also not going to do that. Simply after our calculation, dou square upon dou x n square. So we can simply guess these things, and then we can plug in here. Okay, so to transform the Hamiltonian into relative motion coordinates and also translational motion coordinates. Okay, first in this particular thing, this Hamiltonian has to be transformed into relative motion and translational coordinates. And here that we have dou square upon dou x n square. So to calculate dou square upon dou x n square, first of all, we should calculate dou by dou x n. Dou by dou x n, in terms of partial differentiation, it can be expressed like this. In terms of partial differentiation, it can be written like this. Dou capital X by dou x n, keeping the x e constant, okay? It's the derivative of x, where x is the center of mass, x component of the center of mass, okay? You just have to derivatize that one with respect to x n, that is the nuclear coordinate, keeping the x e as a constant. Multiply that factor with the dou by dou x, plus the other one is the, you have to take the first derivative of the x component of the relative mass coordinate, that is dou x, right? Dou x by, with respect to again the nuclear coordinate, that is xn, keeping the x e constant, and dou upon dou x. So in terms of partial differentiation, so these dou by dou xn can be written like this. Okay, now what is x? X is already, x component of the center of mass is already we have defined. Similarly, the relative x component of the relative mass coordinates also defined, right? Now here it says that dou x by dou x n. That means you have to take derivatize the x component with respect to x n, keeping x e constant. Therefore, if you do that, what will happen? So this is constant. Therefore, the derivative of this one is actually zero, right? And derivative of x n. So we are doing derivative with respect to x n only. Therefore, essentially this is actually m by capital M plus the denominator we have got the small m. So this is that factor, and this factor as such it is here. And what about this? So this you have to derivatize with respect to x n, keeping x e as a constant. So x e as a constant means, so this you can neglect. So you are doing the derivative of this one with respect to x n. Therefore, it is basically minus 1 comes, right? From this actually minus 1, and minus 1 multiplied with dou upon dou x. So this is actually as such it is as now. Okay, similarly, this is one part. Similarly, we should also calculate the x component. Okay, so if you just go back and see here, I tell you that we will calculate the x component, and from this we have dou upon dou square upon dou x square. So to calculate that one, we need a dou upon dou x. So dou upon dou x can be written as this fashion. Okay, so here the x can be expressed by dou upon dou x upon dou x, keeping x n constant, multiplied by dou x by dou x, keeping x n constant, and dou by dou x. So this is just a reverse. You know, in the previous case we have actually kept x e constant, right? If you want this component to be expressed, the x n has to be constant. Okay, so since you have two variables, so one has to be kept constant when you are actually calculating one partial differentiation. That's all it is. So if you calculate this thing, because we know that what is capital X, it is already given, mxn minus small xe by m plus small m, capital M plus small m, right? So from this, you can actually calculate the XC. I did a mistake here. This is supposed to be XC, right? So you can calculate, and that is going to be M by capital M plus small m, dou upon dou X plus dou upon dou X, right? Now, this is the X dou upon dou XL and dou upon dou XC. So there are two things that we have got. So once we have these things, you can just take the square of that. Why you require square of that? Because in the Hamiltonian, we have got dou square upon dou XL square. Similarly, dou square upon dou XC square is there, right? And we got the first derivative. And if you want the square, just simply do the square of that. Okay, please remember that we are not going to calculate for the y component. That will just we will guess it at the end. But you can just the Hamiltonian now. If you only consider the x component, it is going to be like this: minus h cross square by 2m multiplied by. So this actually has come from this. You can notice here, and this actually came from this. Okay, just to say, take the square of that. And then at the end you will have a potential energy terms. Okay, now the next step, what you can do, you can just simply expand it. What is that? It is like the previous expression. If you see here, that this is simply like a minus b whole square, and this is like a plus b whole square, right? So how to expand these things using the simple formulas, that algebra formulas, you know very well, that a minus b whole square is equal to a square plus b square minus 2ab. That's the formula, right? So you can expand it. So when you expand it, then what will happen, that in the first term, that you have actually a minus b whole square, so you will get actually minus 2ab term, right? And the other term, that is the other case, that you have plus 2ab will come, right? So both actually, you know, the cross terms, what I mean to say is that the cross terms actually are basically cancelled each other. So what will remain from both terms is that a square plus b square. Similarly, from the other term, a square plus b square, it will come. So this is what I was talking about, you know. So this is, let's say this is a, this is b, this is c, plus d, right? C plus probably b. C plus actually, this is b, not d. I'm sorry, c plus b, right? So when you do this expansion, that the cross terms actually cancel each other. So only the other terms, square terms, will come in. So this is what it is now. And the outside, please remember, always we have minus h cross square by capital 2m, 2 capital M. And this is m square multiplied divided by m plus small m square, dou square upon dou capital X square. The other square, that is nothing but minus dou upon dou X square, right? So dou X, that square, if you take it, this is dou square upon dou X square. And from the outside, that is minus h cross square by 2 times capital M. So this has come, right? So from the other, again, we have this type of thing, like minus h cross square by 2 times small m square by capital M plus small m square, dou square upon dou x square, capital X square. So minus dou square upon 2 times the mass of electron, dou square upon dou x square, and the kinetic energy. So just the expansion, and please just take a piece of paper and then work it out. This is the expression that you should get it. And if you are not getting, you are always free to discuss with me after the class. Then next is just a simplification. What is the simplification? That you can actually see here, there is one m here, and there is one square inside. So here there is m, and there is one square. So here there is m, this is m. That can be actually cancelled each other. And then h cross square by minus h cross square by 2, you can take it out as a common factor. And from here, capital M by capital M plus small m whole square plus small m by capital M plus volume whole square, okay, which is multiplied by, please remember that both has got this rho square upon rho x square, that is written here. Both are written here, right? Similarly, the from the other terms, what we have is like minus of h cross square by 2 times the capital mass of nucleus plus h cross square by 2 times the mass of electron. So this has, this is that. So these things actually came from this one, and similarly this has come from this one. Okay, of course the potential energy term is not written here just for the sake of simplicity, but this will be carried forward. Okay, now the next step is that you can simplify that. Okay, of course the denominator part is same, both capital M plus small m whole square. So in the top, if you take the summation, that is basically capital M plus small m, and that capital one capital M plus small m cancelled with the denominator capital M plus small m square, right? So the simplification here is minus h cross square by 2 times the capital M plus small m, and from here rho square upon rho capital X square, and from this actually h cross square by 2m, 2 you can take it common factor. So this is essentially, it is going to be 1 over capital M plus 1 over small m rho square upon rho X, right? And then the next part is that, you know, this is essentially nothing but, if you do this, it is nothing but the 1 over reduced mass mu, 1 over reduced mass, right? Because that this is going to be actually it is going to be small m plus capital M by capital M multiplied by small m, right? So that is nothing but the inverse of the reduced mass. So therefore that is basically replaced with mu. So 1 over mu is nothing but that quantity. So from the x component, the Hamiltonian is going to be minus h cross square by 2 times the total mass of the system rho square upon rho capital X square minus h cross square by 2 times the reduced mass rho square upon rho small x square, right? And the y component can be easily written from this x component Hamiltonian, right? It is nothing but h cross square by, all these things are there, rho square upon rho y square, it will come up. Suppose if you want to write the y square term, then here it will be y, right? So that is what it is written here already. I have written here y component and z components are written here. From this experience, from this calculation of x component, we can easily write down what is y component and what is z component. And finally, we can again write down the potential energy term as usual. Okay, that is what it is written. And then you can just do a simplification, taking out the common terms as a common terms you can take out outside, and then write down the other things like minus h cross square by 2 times the total mass of the system, then which is multiplied by rho square upon rho capital X square, and rho square upon rho capital Y square plus rho square upon rho Z square, right? Similarly, the other terms like minus h cross square by 2 times the reduced mass can be taken outside as a common factor, and then this is going to be this. And minus e square upon 4 pi epsilon r bar. And please remember that instead of writing all the time that r e minus r m, I am just replaced with r. You can just even write down simple r. R is the distance between the electron and the nucleus. Okay, now if you simplify further, that this within the bracket, this is nothing but the del operator, but then this del operator is something different. How it is different? This is nothing but, okay, this capital del r bar square. What is r bar? R bar, capital R bar, we define like, you know, this is actually the relative translational coordinates. Okay, translational coordinates, which represent the translational coordinates, which has got three component, x and capital X, y, z components. Similarly, del square suffix the r bar is nothing but the relative mass coordinates, right? R bar actually represents the relative mass coordinates. Okay, and this is something that it is different. This Hamiltonian, if you just compare the previous Hamiltonian, it has nothing actually. What is there? It is very raw Hamiltonian, where minus h cross square by 2 times the mass of nuclei we have written. But here now you see it is the mass of the total system and then multiplied by some del operator. So this is something actually unique about this particular Hamiltonian, right? So this talk about the translational motion of the system. Why? Because as I told you already, as I already described, that if hydrogen atom is translating from in the space, as a whole, the system is basically moving, right? As a whole, if it is moving, the kinetic energy term, actually it should have been instead of just the nucleus, it should have been the total mass of the system, right? So that is something was lacking in the previous case, right? Similarly, the coordinates, you can see here, the del now, it has become the del is basically the center of mass coordinate. Earlier, it was actually a simple XYZ Cartesian coordinates, but now it is actually changed to a new del operator, wherein the center of mass actually during the translation motion, the center of mass is changing. If it is changing, then the del operator should actually describe that motion, right? So both these things actually very interesting and very meaningful. This Hamiltonian is really meaningful in that sense. What about this? This also very same. You can see here that in the reduced mass, in the kinetic energy, the second term, so we describe like the electron. So if the electron is moving, it has got a kinetic energy term that is just written like minus h cross square by 2 times the mass of electron multiplied by del square, right? But here it has got modified to minus h cross square by 2 times the reduced mass. This is also really meaningful because the reduced mass, because you just remember that if the two particles, that is the nucleus and electrons, are moving relative to each other, then the movement actually involves both, right? When the movement, if we have two particles and in their movement, if both particles involved, then naturally the reduced mass should be taken into account instead of taking the mass of electron alone. Isn't it? If only one particle is moving, then obviously we take only one particle mass into the kinetic energy, we'll calculate the kinetic energy. But then when you have a system wherein relatively one is moving relative to the other, then it is quite obvious that we have to account both the masses, right? Right? So that is something that was lacking in the previous Hamiltonian, but it is nicely taken care in this, Hamiltonian after switching over to the translational relative mass coordinates, right? So this is actually overall it is a nice expression that actually describes the translational motion and relative motion. But now the question in but the problem that we have discussed, that hydrogen atom has two motions, one is translational motion, relative motion. Now the translation motion is something that we said, for some reasons it is not of very much interesting. Why? Because that when it is translating as a whole, and its kinetic energy going to change, but that will not be very interesting as far as the chemistry is concerned. What is more interesting is this term, the relative motion. The relative motion actually contains the involvement of both electron and nuclei motion and their interaction as well, right? They are also interacting they are also moving at the same time, they are also interacting. That is something that is very interesting. Now, the Hamiltonian, what we have got is having really described the translational motion and relative motion of the hydrogen atom. And this I am labeling for some reasons with equation number 2. Okay, now this expression you can actually split up into two things, where the total Hamiltonian is basically the summation of translational motion plus the relative motion, right? So this you can take it as a Hamiltonian of translational motion, wherein the center of mass is changing, right? And this you can take it as a relative motion, wherein it's it's a relative, the distance between the two things, the electron and the nucleus, is basically changing. Okay, the total Hamilton can be taken into that. Now this thing, you can actually allow it to operate on some kind of wave function. The total wave function, again, you can take it as a summation of the relative center of mass wave function and also relative mass, the wave function which describe the center of mass and then relative motion. Okay? And the total energy also, it is going to be a center of mass, the summation of the energy that describe the center of motion and the other energy that describe the relative mass. Okay, so the total energy can also be taken into the taken as a summation of these two, and you can simply write down the two. You can simply split up these two equations and separate nicely into two different equations based on these definitions, and then we can write down the expressions like this. What is this? Minus h cross square upon 2 times the capital M plus small m del square suffix capital R bar, which actually is the relative the translation and motion coordinates, right? So capital Cm, that is the wave function of that describe the translation motion, wherein the center of mass is actually changing, right? So you can allow this kinetic energy term to operate upon this wave function. You are going to get the energy. Corresponding energy is the ECM, okay, the center of mass energy, and then the wave function we will get back, right? Similarly, the other function, the relative mass, the other expression, the relative motion expression, can be written, and you can actually nicely separate one from the other, right? And the equation number 3 and 3 and then 4 can be written like this. How we are writing? We are just writing based on just a simple summation of the Hamiltonian, can be taken as a summation. Similarly, the wave function also can be taken as the linear combination of the two wave function, wherein one describes the translation motion, the other describes the relative motion. And the energies also accordingly we can write down, based on which we can actually easily write down two different expressions. And the one expression is something that the equation number 3 we can neglect. We don't have to worry about it, right? Because the translation motion is not very much important, because we have seen already, if you have only kinetic energy term, and solving such a Schrodinger wave equation is very easy, and that is not of very much interesting to us as a chemist. What is interesting is basically this one. Okay, the equation number 4, which describes the relative motion of the hydrogen atom, actually is very, very important. Okay, so this is something that we should keep in mind, and this is the expression hereafter we are going to deal with it, and we don't discuss this actually. We'll only discuss this. Okay, but then it doesn't mean that we doesn't have the translational motion. Yes, it is there. You have a particle, and if it is if you leave that particle in the space, it actually exhibits the translation motion, and which means is that its kinetic energy is changing. Accordingly, its energy is going to change. But that is not of very much interesting to a chemist. What is interesting is only the relative motion. How one is moving with respect to the other is something that is more of interest. And if you try to solve this equation number 4, what we get is very interesting to learn further and further. Okay, we will only deal this equation number 4 hereafter. Now, how do we actually solve this expression? Well, the routine procedure after getting the Hamiltonian is first getting the Hamiltonian is the first task. Now we got it. A decent Hamiltonian, which can be handled. Okay, it should be handled. It's not that simply you got it and accept and do it. No, in the previous cases also that we have tried to go, we try to get the Hamiltonian, which is mathematically handled, which can be mathematically handled. Only then we proceeded to the next step, right? So we got the Hamiltonian now, no problem. That describes only the relative motion, and that is there anyway. Now the next step is what? If you see the relative motion, the wave function actually depends upon what? It depends upon it is basically a three-dimensional problem, right? I don't know how many of you really realize that since we have already discarded the translational motion, by default, the three variables have actually gone. What is left over is that all x, y, z, right? These are the coordinates that describe the relative mass, that describe the relative motion of the hydrogen atom, that describe the relative mass of the hydrogen atom. Now, what is to be done next? Okay, when you come across a wave function which depends upon three variables, what is the thing that we have done in the case of particle confined to three-dimensional box? We try to deal this problem as like a very by following the method of variation and separables, variation of separation of variables method, right? Wherein the total wave function actually depends upon three variables, which can be thought of like it's a product of three wave functions, wherein one wave function depends upon exclusively one variable, the other one depends upon the other variable, and the third one depends upon exclusively on third variable, right? So we can actually think of like expressing the wave function in this fashion. The total wave function can be taken as the product of three, capital X of small y, capital Y of small y, capital Z of small z. This is the product of three wave function, which maybe if you are able to find what is x of x, what is y of y, what is z of z, then that product would give you the total wave function, which would actually satisfy the time independent Schrodinger wave equation that describe the relative motion of the system. That's the idea, right? That's how we have proceeded in the past, and similarly here also we should proceed the same manner. However, that it is not as simple as compared to the previous examples or previous model system that we have discussed. Why? Because if you see carefully the Hamiltonian, it has got the kinetic energy thing due to the relative motion, and this also is the potential energy. What is this potential energy term? It has got 1 over r bar. R bar is nothing but you can just simply take it as r. R is the distance between the nucleus and the electron, right? And how to calculate the distance? The distance, you know, it is nothing but basically the square root of the magnitude of the distance. How do you calculate? Basically, it is nothing but the square root of x square plus y square plus z square, right? And 1 over r bar is nothing but 1 over square root of x square plus y square plus z square, isn't it? The vector notation, I am sure that most of you can recollect vector algebra. And r is nothing but the distance. And the distance in terms of relative mass coordinates, it is nothing but square root of x square plus y square plus z square. If that is the case, now you can look at this expression, that is our equation number 4. Is it possible to handle this expression as such? As such means that what is the procedure? The procedure is that separation of variables, how we have done it in the past, okay? We assume now the total wave function psi relative is a product of three wave function, that is capital X of small y, capital Y of small y, and capital Z of small z, right? You can replace that here, and also you can replace that X, Y, Z. And here also X, Y, Z. Okay. And then, you know, you can shift the functions inside this one. Here there is no operator. Here there is nothing. It is just a 1 over r, right? But the r is, it is square root of x square plus y square plus z square. Now, is it possible that we can actually simply move these expressions outside the integral, outside this. No, suppose if the expression is multiplying with the del operator is a linear operator. Dou square upon dou x square plus dou square upon dou y square plus dou square upon dou z square. It is a linear operator. Whereas here, that is 1 over r bar, r is square root. Square root is not a linear operator. Therefore, we cannot follow the method of separation of variables method as we have followed in the previous model systems to solve the expression. I hope that you are following. Then what is that is something that we have to take into account, that we cannot deal the expression, the Hamiltonian, simply we cannot plug in the values or we cannot simply plug in the total wave function as a x of x, y of y, z of z into the expression. We cannot solve that way. Okay, why? Because we have a non-linear operator, that is square root. Square root is a non-linear operator. If square root is not there, then we can actually solve the equation very easily. Okay, there is a square root. That is the reason that we cannot simply, if there is a square root, you cannot actually simply move the product function, and you cannot have the three different expressions. Just recall the derivation part of the three-dimensional box, particle confined to three-dimensional box. There it was possible because the Hamiltonian and the del operator, they are basically linear operators. Okay, so when they are operating dou square upon dou x square, with regard to that particular thing, y of y, z of z are basically constants. Therefore, you can write outside and then you do that derivation, and whatever it comes, that you can consider. That was the case, right? And finally, we arrived at three different equations, and then in those equations, we tried to solve. And finally, what we got is x of x, y of y, z of z. And the product actually gives you the total wave function of the particle confined to three-dimensional box. But the same logic here, it is not possible, mainly because of the square root. And the square root is not a linear operator. It is a non-linear operator. Now, what is the remedy for this? Well, we will come to that. But before that, let me also tell you what is happening. So 1 over r, r is what? R is the distance, right? If it is the distance, okay, the hydrogen atom relative one with respect to the nucleus, or with respect to nucleus, the electron is actually moving, right? Okay, and if the electron is moving, how it is moving? Is it moving as it likes, or it is moving in a specific way? It is moving in a specific way, right? So the electron in the hydrogen atom is interacting. It is moving, and also it is interacting with the nucleus, and therefore it has got the potential energy term. And the potential energy term says that it is 1 over r. What? It is 1 over r. Okay. Suppose if I say, what is the potential? Just a minute. Well, let's say if I say 1 centimeter, what is the potential of hydrogen atom at 1 centimeter? Suppose if the you just imagine that you have the nucleus of the hydrogen atom, and the electron is somewhere at the distance at 1 centimeter. At 1 centimeter, what is the potential? Okay, now you can calculate E square upon 4 pi epsilon, and then the one you have can substitute, and there is some quantity, you will get it. If I said 1 centimeter, and it doesn't really speak about which direction it is, right? So the 1 centimeter can be this direction, or this direction, or this direction, this direction, this direction. So when you talk about 1 centimeter, what is the potential? It is actually is nothing but the potential is a circle, right? sorry, the potential, when I talk about 1 centimeter, what is the potential at 1 centimeter? It is essentially means the potential on a circle, everywhere on the circle, the potential energy is, I mean, the same. Let's say this is my electron, okay? But the electron is moving in a three-dimensional phase, right? So essentially, the potential, what I wanted to say is that the potential of the hydrogen atom is spherically symmetric. Understand why I said spherically symmetric? Okay, when you say what is the potential at 1 centimeter, so we really don't talk about what is the direction, where, which direction it is, electron. Therefore, any direction at 1 centimeter, everywhere the potential remains the same. And when you try to map the potential of the hydrogen atom at 1 centimeter, that essentially is a circle. Essentially, it is a circle. But there is no hard and fast rule that the electron only moving in a two-dimensional. Actually, electron is moving in three-dimensional, right? Therefore, when you consider three-dimensional, the potential of the system, hydrogen atom, is actually a spherical in nature. Okay, the potential of the hydrogen atom actually is spherical in nature. Now coming to this point that, you know, there are two points to be considered. One is that as such the problem cannot be worked it out because it is a square root a linear, a non-linear operator is there. Another thing is that the hydrogen atom potential is basically a spherically symmetric potential. Therefore, but what we have started with describing hydrogen atom on a Cartesian coordinates. Cartesian coordinates, that is x, y, z. Okay, there are three components to describe the specific position of a particle in three dimension, that we have x, y, z. So the Cartesian coordinates. And these coordinates actually really not applicable for a system when you are discussing about for a system which wherein its potential is basically changing spherically, right? So if you have a spherically symmetric potential, it is appropriate that you should have a spherical, you should have a coordinate system that actually takes care of the spherical symmetric potential. Okay, suppose if you have a potential which basically takes care of the Cartesian three-dimensional thing, cubic symmetry, if the potential is cubic symmetric, then definitely you can go for a Cartesian thing, no problem. But our hydrogen atom potential is actually spherically symmetric, therefore the Cartesian coordinates cannot be used. Okay, and this is the reason why that now we have to take it out, the Cartesian coordinate x, y, z, z into, and we have to replace with a new Cartesian coordinate, new coordinate systems, which really describe the relative, which really describe the potential of the hydrogen atom, right? So there is a coordinate system that is called polar coordinate system. Okay, there is a coordinate system what we refer to as a polar coordinate system, and the polar coordinate system is something actually describe the spherical symmetric systems. Okay, if you have got a system whose potential is changing spherically, then for that particular system, it is appropriate that one should use the polar coordinate system. Okay, it is appropriate. But our problem right now, what is there? It is there in the Cartesian coordinates. Now we have to actually switch over our problem, you know, Cartesian coordinate problem into polar coordinate system. That is another thing that we should do now, right now, immediately. Okay, so you got it, right? Suppose if you are asked to a question like this, what is the need and necessity of changing hydrogen atom Hamiltonian into polar coordinate system, then you should say two answers, that the square root function, basically the distance, or r bar is the distance between the electron and neutron, the nucleus, which is essentially square root of x square plus y square plus z square. Right, the square root function is not a linear operator, it is in fact it's a non-linear operator. Therefore, we cannot follow the procedure of separation of variable method as we did it in the past few other cases. Okay, therefore, there is a need and necessity that we should go for some system, coordinate system, which actually describe, which actually takes care of this problem. Okay, that is one thing. Second thing is that hydrogen atom has got a spherically symmetric potential, right? So for spherically symmetric potential, we should use a polar coordinate system. Cartesian coordinate system is not appropriate for a spherically symmetric potential. We have to switch over to a appropriate coordinate system that is already identified, which is nothing but the polar coordinate system. I'm sure that all of you would have actually learned what is polar coordinate system. And the polar coordination system is nothing but any coordinate system, the idea is same. The idea or the purpose is same, introducing any coordinate system. The purpose is that, you know, how to describe a point, how to describe a point in the space, right? So in the Cartesian coordinate, what we do, suppose if you have a point, okay, let's say you have a point like this. So how do you describe its position? Well, so what we do, we take with respect to some origin, we keep it, okay? We will have an origin, and then with respect to origin, we draw three different directions, right? X, Y, Z, right? X, Y, Z. So three different directions we take it. And then what we do, the moment I have a point in the space, then from the point, we try to draw the projection to the respective axes. Respective axes. And then we consider, okay, from the point is from X to Y, from on the x-axis, it is making a projection of 2 centimeters, that 2 centimeters, no? So we will take that X as a 2. And the projection of Y is, if it is 3, then we will say 3. And then if the projection, which we have already defined, okay, the point is at 2, 3, 4 away from the origin, 2, 3, 4 centimeters. All these things you can take it as a unit, maybe centimeter or meter or kilometer, whatever, it doesn't matter. But then that is the idea. Okay, so I'm sure that you, I need not to give much more much more on this Cartesian coordinates, how to define a point, that is known. Now the polar coordinate system, we don't use this. As I told you that we have a necessity to switch over to polar coordinate system. But in the polar coordinate system also, to describe, we need some three coordinates. Okay, essentially we need three coordinates. And I will try to introduce one by one what is what are those coordinates. Let me do that. In this particular case, you can see here the projection. This is the this is nothing but the Z, and essentially this is our X component and Y component. These are the Cartesian coordinate definitions. Now, this particular thing, let us imagine that in the polar coordinate system, we can actually, okay, you consider the origin. From the origin, how far the point is, you can take that particular thing as a one variable. To describe the position of a point in the space, one particular variable which we can consider is the r. R is the distance between the particle or the point, okay, from the origin. Okay, so it can be 2 centimeter, 3 centimeter, 4 kilometer, so likewise. So r can actually takes care of the distance between the origin and the point. That is what it is. Now, similarly, we can also introduce the angle, you know, the angle that this point actually makes with respect to z-axis, positive z-axis. Okay, so the other variable to describe the position of a particle in polar coordinate system, that is the angle. It is not the unlike the Cartesian coordinate, it's not like a, another variable, but it is the angle. So what is the angle? So as I told you, that you can just draw a line. You can just draw a line that actually pass through the point from the origin to the from the origin to the point. You just imagine a plane. Okay, you just imagine a plane. So I have my z-axis here. Now, just imagine my point is somewhere here. What you do, my origin is at this place. So you just draw, join the origin and the point. It has become a plane now. You just imagine a plane. Okay, just imagine a plane that actually joins the point. And then if you like it, the angle with which it basically makes with respect to positive z direction can be taken as a one variable. Okay, in that particular case, it is essentially the theta is the angle which it makes with respect to positive z axis. With respect to positive z axis. So it is the angle. Okay. Now, when I say two variables, still we are not actually specifying the position of the particle. Why? Because if I say, for example, r is 5 feet, if r is 5 feet and theta is, let's say, 45 degrees, if theta is, r is this, where we are? Well, where we are now? So I told you that you have to first draw a line that actually makes, that basically connects the point and the origin, right? And now r is 5 feet means from the origin you have to imagine, you have to mark a point, right? You have to mark a point that is 5 feet, right? And then now the angle that it is making is 45 with respect to positive direction. It is 45. Then this 45, this particular description is not sufficient to describe fully the position. Why? Because see, this direction also I can have the same phenomena, right? The point also can be here. Why I said it's a positive, the angle it is making with respect to z-axis, it can also be here. It need not be only on the positive side, it can be also the other side. Why? Because I said r is 5 feet. So the same 5 feet, I can imagine a point here, and the same 45 angles, again I can make 45 degrees, that is 45 degrees this direction, and still I can say that this is the point, right? So that means essentially we are not describing correctly the position of the point. Therefore, for that reason, another variable is needed. Now that is actually introduced with respect to this, the angle. The angle with which it makes with respect to xz plane. Okay, the angle with which it makes with respect to xz plane. Okay, so that is phi, that is the third variable. So with these three variables, r, theta and phi, it is enough, and then we can basically describe any system which is basically rotating. Right, in the polar coordinate system, these are the variables, and the further details probably you can just go through a lot of material, YouTube content, and so many things are available. Because of the time, I am unable to take fully, and moreover, it is a bit difficult to explain the polar coordinate system on a just by sitting. So we need some little bit of imagination, and only when we are physically here, it is possible to explain. But then, I suggest strongly all of you just go through the YouTube. A lot of videos are there, polar coordinate system, and many animated videos also there. Just go through it, you will get the complete picture. The purpose is same, whether it is a Cartesian coordinate or the polar coordinate system. The purpose is to specify the position of a position of a particle. Okay. In the space, if you have a particle, how to specify the particle, right? So Cartesian coordinate, we use x, y, z coordinates, whereas in the polar coordinates, that has to be r, theta, phi. Now the question is, how do we convert these values, x, y, z, into, in terms of Cartesian coordinate, what are the equivalents, Okay, in XYZ, we don't write anything. Just we take, those are just number, we take it. But then in the R theta phi, okay, if we have, what we have right now is the Hamiltonian XYZ, right? But then in R theta phi, how do you convert it? So individually, you can just do a simple trigonometry by using these projections and drawing these lines and all. It is possible that easily you can make out. So in terms of polar coordinates, the Cartesian coordinate can be expressed, and z is nothing but r cos theta, y is nothing but r sin theta sin phi, and x is nothing but r sin theta cos phi. Okay, so how to arrive these things, these numbers? So please refer the YouTube content, and a lot of videos are there, and you can actually do that, or else you can just memorize these numbers, that is sufficient. Now there is one interesting part which is left over still, that what are those values and what are the limitations of these numbers is something that we should discuss, because those are important things to describe fully the position of a particle or anything in the space. Then basically we need three variables in the polar coordinate system. Those are r, theta, phi. So the value from the value of r can be varied from 0 to infinity. R can be 0. That means you can actually, the particle can reside just exact on top of the origin. So in that case, r can be 0. On the other hand, or the particle can be at the infinite distance. In that case, r will be infinity. Now, what about the theta? Theta is the angle, that the positive angle that it makes with respect to z axis. So the z value actually, it can be positive direction this way, or it can be the other way. I told you that the theta, when you define theta, it is nothing but the line actually which joins the origin and the point. And that particular line, what is the angle that it makes with respect to positive z direction? So it is enough that r, if r is basically moving, varying from 0 to pi. If I say theta, the theta value can vary from 0 to pi. Okay, it is nothing but the positive, the angle which making with the positive z axis. So you can just imagine a line that passes through the line and then origin, and this is the angle that we are talking, and this is the angle that we have defined as the theta. Okay, suppose if theta is, if theta is 0, means that the particle will be here in the, on the z axis itself. On the other hand, if I say if theta is 45, it is somewhere here. If it is 60, it is somewhere here. If it is 90, means, if theta is 90, means it is along the y-axis. It is on the y-axis. If theta is 135, this is somewhere here. And if theta is 180, so this is somewhere here. So z minus z axis is here, right? So our negative z axis here. So if the theta is varying from 0 to 5, that is sufficient, right? And what about 5? So the phi angle is defined with respect to xz plane. So this particular area, what we define to as xz plane. Okay, so you just draw a line, you just imagine a plane. The theta is nothing but, you just imagine this plane. What is this plane? This one. This is the plane. Okay, this is the plane that you just imagine. Okay, where you have a point and that passes through this. Now this angle is, okay, if it is in the xz plane, if this plane is in the xz plane, then the phi is 0. Okay, if the plane is here on the xz plane, then naturally the phi is 0. On the other hand, it can vary, and then the plane, you know, starting from xz plane to this one, it can make a round, and then come back and then come to again xz. So the theta actually can vary from the phi can actually vary from 0 to 2 pi. Okay, so these are the number that you should remember. And then And then there is another point that maybe we will discuss later, that is the volume element. Volume element, we will come to that. But essentially what we should remember that the Cartesian coordinates can be expressed in terms of polar coordinates. Okay, polar coordinates system is something that it is ideal for the system like hydrogen atom. Why? Because its potential energy is spherical in nature, and moreover it's a it has got the Hamiltonian has got a non-linear operator, that is square root. It cannot be handled. Therefore, the polar coordinate system that we should use it, and the x component is defined to be in terms of polar coordinate, that is nothing but the r sine theta cos phi. Y is nothing but r sine theta sine phi, and z is nothing but r cos theta. Okay, so the each Cartesian coordinate can be expressed in terms of r theta phi. Okay, so having understood this, next our job is that these x, y, z. Now, what is x, y, z in terms of polar coordinates are expressed here. Now, what is our Hamiltonian? If you go back and see, our Hamiltonian is nothing but minus h cross square by 2 times the reduced mass multiplied by del small r e square, right? So that is basically the relative dou square upon dou x square plus dou square upon dou y square plus dou square upon dou z square, right? And then minus e by 4 pi epsilon r bar. So the first of all, we have to, what is x? X is already here in terms of polar coordinates, already here, r sine theta cos phi. So you have to first calculate dou upon dou x, okay? And then later you have to calculate the dou square upon dou x square. Okay, dou upon dou x, first we have to calculate. From that, we have to evaluate dou square upon dou x square. So after getting that, you have to plug in the Hamiltonian. Similarly, y we know, y component, r sine theta sine phi. And then that has to be calculated first derivative, and then take the first, second derivative of the this one. Then plug in there. Similarly, z component. So after substituting there, the Hamiltonian, total Hamiltonian basically will convert into the polar coordinates. That is something that we should do, and then we will discuss this aspect in the next class. So for today, what you should remember that what we have discussed today is basically hydrogen atom. What is hydrogen atom? What is its Hamiltonian? And the original Hamiltonian, what we have written, has a fundamental problem wherein it doesn't really describe the translational motion and the relative motion of the hydrogen atom. So what we did was we tried to convert the Hamiltonian into translational motion coordinates and also relative mass coordinates. We have done that. Later, what we did was we tried to solve, but then we understood a problem that it cannot be just handled as such because it has got a square root operator. And also, we understood that its potential energy is spherically symmetric. Therefore, a polar coordinate system has been introduced very briefly. And now the job is that we have to convert the hydrogen atom Hamiltonian, which is there in the Cartesian coordinates, which should be converted into the polar coordinate system. Then we can solve the expression. Then that particular Hamiltonian we can plug in into the hydrogen atom Schrodinger wave equation. Then we can solve that expression. So that we will discuss in the next class.